with that, we'll move over to our session on neuroprosthetics. The organizers are Tim Dennison from Medtronics and Justin Williams from University of Wisconsin in Madison. And so, gentlemen, I'll turn it over to you.
I'm Justin Williams, University of Wisconsin, and Tim Dennison, our co-chair, he'll be moderating this session today. He's a little more intimidating than I am, so he'll keep this on track. It was nice about 3 years ago at the German American FOE, we had a neuroengineering session. At the end of this, we had a brief couple slides on neuroprosthetics, and I'm really glad that introduction has now blossomed into we have a whole session on neuroprosthetics. So for those of you who may not be familiar with that word, it's fairly intuitive. That is, we're in general talking about devices that we can implant into the nervous system to either diagnose, treat, or augment physiological function. And so the goal here today is to try to bring you up to speed on where this field is and help you draw a line, what is science fiction and what is reality, and really where is this field headed and how it's going to impact your life. So since I'm pretty certain that most of you probably have not had any kind of neurophysiology in the recent future, we'll do a quick little fun rundown to try to introduce some of the basic concepts here. So starting up here, this is a neuron. So a single cell, the features we're interested in, of course, we have a cell body and then this long spindly axon off one end and dendrites on the other. And the reason this is important are that we think about these as engineers as little transmission elements. That is, information comes into the dendrites and flows out the axon. And at the end of the axon, it impinges on the dendrites of another cell and communicates that information. And that's how electricity travels through your body, one axon to a dendrite, on and on and on. So if you put a bunch of these together, we see that they form networks. And if we zoom out a little bit more, we see that the brain is organized functionally. That, for example, in this fMRI view, we have this is the part of the brain that lights up when you think about moving your arm. So we have anatomical areas that are dedicated to the functions of our body. And that'll become important as we talk about how do we tap into the brain and know where we should put things. So some fun things, of course, to give you the scale and the complexity of the types of problems that we're interested in. There's roughly 100 billion neurons in your brain. That's a hard number to really get a feel for. And there's also many other types of cells. The neurons are actually the least abundant cell in your brain. We have glial cells, oligodendrocytes that make up all the structural elements to keep your brain from being just a bowl of soup. And the neat part is that every neuron connects to at least another 1,000 neurons. So we're talking about over a quadrillion connections in all. And that's obviously very difficult to keep track of. So we have to rely on other means to try to figure out what all this means. Neurons come in all shapes and sizes. And the reason this is important is that there's actually more types of neurons than there are all the other types of cells in your body. And two neurons that look exactly the same may have completely different functions. So again, we always have to be able to understand both what a neuron looks like, also what it does. So a couple other things they're kind of fun to think about. There's the old wives' tale that you only use 10% of the brain. That's not true. You use all of your brain, maybe not this early in the morning, but eventually throughout the day, you'll engage all 100 billion of those cells. And that comes from this fact that many people didn't understand what these glial cells were doing and didn't consider them important. And of course, we lose neurons anywhere from 50,000 to 100,000 a day. 50,000 if you went to bed right after dinner last night, probably 100,000 if you stayed at Trader Vic's a little later. Luckily, though, they all grow back eventually. More when you're younger, fewer of them grow back as we age. So neuroscience always seems immediately attractive to, particularly my engineering students, because if we start to think about what a simple network of neurons or even a kind of more complicated network of cells in the hippocampus, all the networks that form short-term memories in your brain, students almost immediately gravitate to their intuition, which is that all these little cells and their connections look like circuit elements that we would imagine in a modern integrated circuit. And so the thought here is that neuroengineering, in many ways, people start to gravitate towards one of two applications. That is, can we take these neurons and use the tools that we know that we have to organize the structure of circuits to produce artificial neural networks in addition? This is a slide from Bill Shane's work, one of our collaborators. And can you put neurons where you want to and pre-describe their connections? And is this the future of how we're going to make computer chips someday? Or the alternative, that is, can we take a computer chip, insert it into the brain, and be able to tap into these networks and to get some utility? And that's the application we're going to be interested in today. So to kind of bring you up to speed, neuroprosthetics is a fairly mature field. There are a number of different clinical applications, from treatment of Parkinson's disease to these treatments of epilepsy. What you'll notice immediately, though, are that these devices are relatively crude. I apologize, Tim. This is one of your devices. And most of their history has evolved from the development of the pacemaker. So we often consider these as not heart pacemakers, but brain pacemakers. And I think Tim would agree that there's quite a bit of improvement that we can do. But the bottom line is that these devices work. We can treat epilepsy. We can treat Parkinson's disease very well with even these relatively crude devices. So we feel like there's a lot of room for improvement with advances in modern engineering technology. Just as a caveat, for those of you who may be a little bit squeamish, you will see some pictures of blood and brain, and just to, so you're not shocked when one of those comes up on the screen. So now, even though that's our modern view of clinical neuroprosthetics, I think the view that most people immediately gravitate is the ones that our current pop culture feeds us on a semi-routine basis, either in books or movies. So a quick scan of the kinds of movies, at least some recent, some of them not so recent. We see lots of applications where in the view of Luke Skywalker, after he loses his arm, he can get an artificial arm that is directly connected into his nervous system, so he doesn't have to now think about the movement of his fingers. Things like Star Trek, in which we can take a blind person and through the augmentation of an implanted device, restore their sight. Can we tap into people's hippocampus and read their dreams and memories, all the way to can we, in the case of Avatar, control a completely external person or creature through a brain interface? And, of course, the dark side of all of this, things like the Manchurian Candidate, people often start to think, well, if I put an implant into my brain, could someone else control my thoughts? We won't get into that, but that's a very interesting philosophical discussion. So with that, I will turn things over to Jim.